I've been a medical missionary now for over 28 years. I've been 105 nations and been responsible for over 200 medical teams going out. I was either on those trips or responsible for them over this period of time. I just actually don't keep track anymore. But about 3 years ago, the Lord laid on my heart to write these books, When All Plans Fail. In fact, people told me don't name books When All Plans Fail. This is the book and this is the workbook. After I'd written the book, people said they wanted to have it in a workbook format, and so that's why we created that. But people said, don't name your book When All Plans Fail. People say that's just too negative. Actually had one publisher that wanted to publish, but they said, if we publish the book, we'll have to change the name. But I said, but God gave me that name because I believe all of man's plans are going to fail. But God's plans never fail. And one of the interesting things that came out of that, which I thought was kind of funny, you know, people pay money to be able to be first on a Google search. Try it out sometime. There is not one other book in the world that's ever been called When All Plans Fail. So whenever you do a Google search, that's who you'll see. You'll see When All Plans Fail. In fact, if you do want to communicate with me at some time, just write to Doctor, D-O-C-T-O-R, at whenallplansfail.com. That's an easy one to remember. And that's the website, www.whenallplansfail.com. But I have a Ministry International Healthcare Network. That's the group that we work through taking these different mission trips. I was twice to Haiti last year. But God has given me some rather unique experiences. And I tell you what, we're living in a very unusual day. Anybody not believe that? We are unusual times. It's almost at a time when we're not sure how much our government really understands what our own needs are, where we want to go. I believe that the fact that we haven't been supporting Israel the way that we ought to be supporting Israel as a nation is to our detriment as a nation. And I've really felt as if we're going to be seeing more disasters, and that's what's been happening. It's hard to believe this year. I mean, when I stop and think about the tsunami and the earthquake over in Japan, and I think about the flooding in the Mississippi, and I think about drought in other areas here in Texas, also in Oklahoma, severe drought like back in the 20s and 30s when we had the very severe drought, and then the wildfires and fires that are going out in Arizona right now. Of course, you had the fires here and you had flooding here, and then these terrible tornadoes. I mean, 1,000 tornadoes, more than 1,000 tornadoes in the month of April. Just unprecedented. And not just mild or small tornadoes. I mean, those F5s in Tuscaloosa, Alabama, and I just got back from Joplin last week and saw some of the devastation there. I'll go into more of that in the breakout session this afternoon. But the devastation that we're seeing in our land right now, and I stop and think about some of the devastation there in Joplin. When I looked at it, it's about 1 mile by about almost 6 miles long. The devastation looks like a war zone. And I've been in many very tragic disasters around the world. Back in the 90s, I was in Bangladesh, where 150,000 people died overnight with a tidal wave that came up through the Bay of Bengal. I worked on the island of Ketubdia, where 40,000 people died in one night. And we were the first relief effort after 3 weeks. Helicopters from the U.S. Army helicoptered us into that island. But we were the first relief effort after 3 weeks. In the United States, if we don't have somebody there in a few hours, everybody's complaining. But we don't understand to what degree that we are blessed by the resources that we have. But I think Katrina taught us very much that we can't rely on those resources that are available normally, because that was not a normal situation, and we have to individually be prepared. In fact, that's been the message that I have, and that's what's in the book, books here. It's not like CERT training or telling you how to respond to help other people. This is for you to get prepared yourself, for you and your family. And also there's information there about churches taking up the mantle and taking on the mantle and also becoming involved. And I really applaud ADRN for what you're doing. It's really a goal of my heart with International Healthcare Network for us to be able to develop and come alongside other organizations like ADRN that are wanting to network believers around the United States. In fact, That's one of the things that we did last week when we were in Joplin, where we're trying to develop a long-term strategy for networking Christian organizations that stay on the ground for beyond the initial immediate relief phase. And so there's a lot of work that needs to be done. It's going to be years, actually, before some of that comes back into normalcy in that particular area. And not only was I in Bangladesh, but I also went over to Goma, Zaire, and some of you probably remember when the Hutus and the Tutsis have been fighting over there, and Zaire is now called Congo, the Republic of Congo, but at the time it was Zaire, and over 500,000 to 1 million people killed each other over in Rwanda, and so we arrived in the 90s again to that area of Goma. And the day we arrived, there were 10,000 bodies on the ground, and over 6 weeks, 60,000 people died, worked among 450,000 people in a refugee camp up there in Katali, and saw such incredible devastation. But the thing I want to point out with that particular story is that after we had been there for about 6 weeks, and we ultimately had like a 6 months presence with the organization, I was with Operation Blessing at that time, we started their medical division. But after about 6 weeks there, they erected a tent for a church, and they named the church, God Walks in This Place. Now, in the middle of some of the greatest disaster and tragedy that you can ever imagine, that when you bring the love of Jesus Christ to people, that they can see Jesus in us. And the Bible says, let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father, which is in heaven. And when we go in the name of Jesus Christ, we are able to actually touch and forever revolutionize and change people's lives. And that's what I would challenge us to do. Another major disaster I was involved with was over in Banda Aceh, Indonesia. Remember when the earthquake occurred over there? It was about an 8.2 on the Richter scale. Caused about a 30, 40-foot wall of water to go into Indonesia, as well as many other nations were impacted. But the greatest loss of life was in Indonesia. About 200,000 people died there. And we took in a team of 25 medical personnel, actually 25 from the United States and about 20 from Indonesia. And the interesting thing was we actually had Somebody Cares as one of the partners that was working over there. And Doug Stringer is here, and Somebody Cares was actually part of that effort as well. And we took that medical team in into an area of Indonesia that you could not otherwise go in. It was under Sharia law, and normally they did not want to have you involved at all. And with that area as Christians, in fact, I had one doctor walk up to me and say, you know, there's three groups of people we don't like around here. One of them's Americans, the other one's Christians, and the other one's military. Well, those are the only three groups of people that were helping them. But I tell you, it's something to which when we have the love of Jesus Christ in our life, that even when people do not know him, just as Daniel was saying, talking to that person, well, do you believe in prayer? Do you believe in God? And, you know, I believe in a higher power. Well, when we show the love of Jesus Christ, we manifest Christ, and we make a real difference in their lives. So I really am wanting to challenge you to get involved yourself. Would you go ahead and put up the first PowerPoint, if you would, that actually, that's not the first one, I don't believe. There's one that shows the, there, that's one. This is actually just shows to be prepared and don't be a victim. That's really something that I'm really trying to use as a motto, trying to challenging people. By the way, are you aware that many times it's 3, 4, 5 days before emergency crews can get to you if there happens to be a major disaster? We only have a limited number of crews, and if it's a major disaster, you have to be prepared yourself to take care of yourself and to take care of your family and your neighbors, and so you have to be prepared. At one time, when I wrote the book, you'll see in there that I state that there's 10 to 15% of people that are actually prepared for disasters. I have found as I've gone around speaking and actually being on the ground, that percentage is probably less than 5%. Most people are not ready. And a lot of people get excited about how they're going to help other people, but they themselves are not prepared. I've gone, in fact, here in Texas, I actually spoke at a group of first responders up in Tyler, Texas, and several hundred people were up there, and they were all first responders, and they all knew exactly what to do with disasters. And I asked them how many of them were actually prepared themselves for their own families, and very few raised their hands. They're ready to go respond to help other people, but they themselves are not prepared. And I'll tell you what, I remember this one story down in Katrina where a physician was involved, and after the terrible devastation, the first thing that they did is said, do I go to the clinic, or do I go to the hospital, or do I go take care of my family? And the choice that they made was to go take care of their family first before they got involved with others. And I think that would be most of our responses. You got to make sure that your own family is cared for, and once they're safe, then you go and help others. So that's a very major issue that I'd really like to challenge you in. Next. We really need to understand the times that we live in. It's amazing. I personally am of the opinion that we're going to be seeing more natural disasters. Some people will say it's related to our climate change. Other people say that's not what's involved at all. Some people say it's related to how we're treating Israel. Other people don't have that opinion at all. Whatever it is, whatever the different reasons are, we are seeing an absolute increase in disasters. The next slide. You know, one of the things that people do so often is they'll cry wolf. In fact, this is one of the chapters in the book I have titled Crying Wolf. You know, when Y2K occurred, a lot of people prepared. And when I have, when I attend seminars, people come up to me and say, you know, don't realize how much stuff I still have in my basement left over from Y2K. And bought generators and extra food and everything, and I never had to use it. Well, I said, that's like complaining that you didn't have to use your life insurance. You know, I mean, you buy life insurance, but not hoping you never have to use it. But these days we're living in is even different than that. And I think one of the things that's unfortunate about Y2K is that it has desensitized some people to where that they're not as sensitive. Oh, you cried wolf back there at Y2K, and you're crying wolf again. Well, that's not the case. I really believe this is a different day. This is a different time. We have never had the magnitude of disasters, the severity of disasters. How many times are you hearing when a disaster occurs, records are being set? Even the heat wave that's going on right now, records are being set. And I remember even the wildfires that occurred out in California. I used to live in California for a number of years. I don't remember a million people being displaced in the wildfires previously. And I think it was a year ago, maybe 2 years ago now, a million people displaced. I mean, these are numbers that we just haven't been thinking about. And so the magnitude of disasters is just really increasing, as well as the frequency. Next. One of the problems that we run into so often is people just somehow believe it's just not going to happen to them. And so they're not prepared. But I tell you what, when God closed the door on the ark, at that particular point in time, there was no recourse. The rain started falling, the water started to rise. And so if you're not prepared ahead of time, you're not going to find yourself being able to get ready in short notice. In fact, when there's a real disaster, what happens to your mind? Your mind goes blank sometimes. Some people get panicky. And then trying to think about, what is it that I have to take with me? What do I need to put together as a grab-and-go bag, whether at home or in my car, or if you're at work when a disaster occurs and you can't go home, are you going to be ready? And unfortunately, too many people have the attitude, it's not going to happen to me. But look at this next slide. This is actually all disasters, which includes drought, earthquake, extreme temperatures. You don't have extreme temperatures here in Texas, do you? I tell you what, one of the things when I was at the conference last year, I talked about putting some food and other things in the cars and with your grab-and-go bags. And they said, well, what happens when it gets up to 160 degrees inside my car or hotter? What do I do? And what about medications that I want to put there? And I said, well, you know, you do have to think of some alternatives when you start dealing with temperatures like that inside of closed cars. And we'll talk about that more later. But floods, insect infestations, slides, volcanic eruptions. By the way, there's more predictions of maybe some volcanic activity even here in the United States. Up in the northwest United States, there's been some fears of volcanic activity. And in fact, they've been saying that since the Japanese earthquake occurred, they're real concerned about the Cascadia Fault, that if that should go off and if it should be of the magnitude of what they had over in Japan, they would anticipate a 100-foot wall of water would come in on the west coast, and the Washington, Oregon, and maybe the northern part of California. And of course, everybody's concerned about the San Andreas Fault, but now over the last couple of years, there's been increased interest in the New Madrid Fault, New Madrid, however you want to pronounce that. And they've actually done a major exercise in the month of May with FEMA. What would they do if the New Madrid should go off and if it should ever be of the magnitude of back in the early 1800s where it was an 8 or greater on the Richter scale? Did you know the Mississippi River actually flowed in reverse direction? I think Lake Bigfoot near Memphis was actually formed out of that. And if that should happen, all the bridges in Mississippi would be destroyed most likely if it really was a major one like an 8. And see, the homes and the buildings along the Mississippi were not designed for those strong earthquakes. And so earthquake of that magnitude has not occurred since they've built all these bridges, since they've built all the homes along there. Maybe some of the newer buildings are now meeting this type of earthquake code, because the earlier ones were not up to that code. And so we would see massive destruction and loss of life. And so people who live in that particular area are going to be particularly needful of being ready themselves individually. And so those are major problems. Next slide. This one actually just shows the earthquakes versus climate disasters. Some people trying to relate some of the climate chain and how many different types of problems that we're having. Next slide. You know, the sensible man, the Bible says in Proverbs 27:12, it says, the sensible man, when he sees a problem coming, this is paraphrased, he prepares for it, but the foolish man doesn't and suffers the consequences. Next slide. It's something that, you know, to fail to plan is to plan to fail. Plan ahead, as that slide so aptly illustrates. The next slide. And you've all heard the story about for want of a nail, you know, a horseshoe was lost for want of a horseshoe, a horse was lost for want of a horse, a rider was lost for want of a rider, the battle was lost, and for want of a battle, the war was lost. Well, all for the want of a horseshoe nail. And so very simple things, little things, are the things that make a difference. It's a accumulation of many little things that ultimately bring about the greatest disasters. It's not just always the big things that we forget, it's the little things that we don't pay attention to. The next slide. And so often we're in that Hispanic mode, mañana, voy a hacerlo mañana, we'll do it tomorrow. And but mañana sometimes doesn't come, it happens today, and we have to be ready. The next slide. I put this one in here for 911. You can when I was up in Joplin, I actually have on my phone right now one of the fire stations that was damaged with the tornado and would have trouble responding. And then also I have pictures of the hospital that was absolutely devastated. When you look at that, I mean, you cannot believe the devastation. The cars around that are absolutely smashed. They look like they came out of junkyards that were squashed down. Sometimes the entire tops of vehicles are missing. They are just absolutely squashed. And this is in the parking lot of the hospital. In the hospital, the ceiling tiles are all hanging down. It would have been an absolute scary event to have been in that hospital when that tornado went through that. So you can't always depend on your 911 being able to reach anyone. By the way, in some of those disasters, you could have dialed 911 and gotten nobody. The communication would be down. You couldn't get a hold of anyone. You've got to be prepared yourself. The next slide. Having a plan will give peace of mind. I actually tell this story in the book about this individual who was, I believe it was in February of 93 when the Twin Towers was first bombed up in New York. And the person said, I'm going to make a plan that if ever this is ever attempted again, I'm going to try to figure out a way to, how will I get out of this tower if ever it should be bombed again? Well, this, of course, when 911 happened on 2001, he happened to be in the area above where one of the planes hit, and he actually had to execute the plan that he had made many years before. And he was one of the few people above where the plane hit that got out, because he had a plan ahead of time. And so knowing what to do, having had a plan, is what gives you that peace of mind. I stop and think about pilots. There's that story of this woman coming up to this pilot and was very enamored by the glamour of someone that was a pilot of these big planes. And she said, "Oh, you must live an exciting life." He says, "Not if I can help it." So we don't want to have an exciting life. Let's have the things worked out ahead of time. And of course, pilots are trained in simulation flights all the time, to where disasters are orchestrated for them in simulators, and they're having to learn how to respond to them. They don't wait until an actual disaster happens to be able to practice it. They have to practice it ahead of time. So having a plan will help give peace of mind. I have an email that was sent to me from a friend out of Nashville that I'd just like to share with you. He was involved with the flooding of Nashville. Remember May of last year, I believe it was, when they had such severe flooding there. And of course, now they were having the flooding this year in other areas. But this is what he wrote. This is written by Don. He says, "Dr. Williams, Nashville and surrounding cities are still in recovery of a major disaster caused by 36 hours of continuous rainfall. This was not a 100-year flood, but a 500-year flood. Many people lost their homes and their businesses in the 36 hours of rainfall. The insurance companies would not even give flood insurance because the area was not within the 100-year flood plain. I believe this is over $1 billion worth of damage, and the long-range effect will take years to recover. I read your book and did what I could to get ready. We live in a high hill and did not have water damage, yet we lost power, phone lines, and water. I'm writing to you from my iPhone because I still have no internet access through the iPhone lines. We had 10 gallons of water and dried food and charcoal and a grill to eat for the last 3 days. Those who were moving out of the flood zones were hit with the roads washed out and suddenly had nowhere to go. They sat in their vehicles for 30 hours. Now, can you imagine if you didn't have any kind of goods inside your car at that time? If you didn't have any food or didn't have any means of filtering water. You had plenty of water around you, but if you didn't have any means of purifying or making it safe to drink, you would really be in difficult straits. In fact, they ended up telling me, he said he and his wife would go down to the people below their home and actually give them water and food because people sitting out in their cars had nowhere to go. All major roads in and out of Nashville were either completely stopped or extremely limited. When we found a grocery store out of the flood area, they would only take cash or local checks. That's the other thing you need to be aware of. ATMs are not going to work many times. Your credit cards are not going to work. You're going to need to be able to have small bills and cash on hand to be able to buy things. And you don't want to have a $100 bill to pay for a $5 item. So you need to have small bills. All their refrigerated foods had to be thrown away. Without water, you have no showers, washing dishes, or toilets. We just got the shovel and did the camping method. For bathrooms, and your horses and zebras chapter is very insightful. I'm going to talk about that in a moment. Because what can happen will happen. We did a lot of what your book said, but did not invest enough in preparation along with practicing those possibilities. By the way, in that regard, I've actually run into some people now who, as a church, have decided they're going to practice it. They've gotten their people to say, for 24 hours, turn off all the electricity to your home, figure out what you're going to do if you don't have your normal services available to you, and just see how you would fare. And actually practice it to see what it is that you would actually do. Many people did not know where to go or to meet up with their loved ones. In fact, Don was telling me that to get to their daughter, they had to use a boat to be able to get to where their daughter was because they were isolated by the water. The phone service was immediately overwhelmed and communications disappeared quickly. At this point, 2 days after the storms, we cannot bathe and water must be boiled. He says for 5 minutes, but I'm going to share with you that you really don't have to boil it for 5 minutes. But anyway, they were boiling their water if you have power and gas stoves. I could go on, but I want to thank you and encourage you to continue with all the due haste with your message of preparedness. It truly was our most important job to be ready when all plans failed. So I appreciated him taking the time to write that because it illustrates in a very practical way things that would be affecting people right here in the States. It's not always those people some other place. It can happen right here. Next slide. And so the message is, and I hear it so often because I fly so often, the flight attendants say, put your own mask on first before you try to help someone else. And that's the message that I have for you. Put your own mask on first. And in the back of the book and then also the workbook, I have a 21-day plan, an action plan to delineate the different things that need to be done, breaking it down into simple categories. In fact, the book really was written not to try to go into such detail like some of the books that are out there, just fantastic books. If you need to know what food, what plants can be food, you know, how to live with nothing else and, you know, live off the land. This is not that kind of book. This is a book that is meant for practical preparedness for you, you and your family, and it's trying to motivate the 90% to 95% of people that are not prepared. Now, those people that want to get into the survival and very more difficult things, there's other books out there that will give you that type of thing. This is a very practical thing with lists that you can go shopping with and help you decide what it is that I need to use for my grab-and-go bag at home and work and also in my car, and what to do to handle various unique situations. And we'll be getting into that again in just a little bit. Next slide. Horses or zebras. This is one of my favorite stories. I went to Washington University School of Medicine in St. Louis, and when they would teach us how to diagnose various problems, they would say common things happen commonly. That makes sense, doesn't it? But it happened to be a referral center, and so Washington University, common things were not the things we saw. In fact, I used to think when I was on my pediatric rotation that the most common rash in children was lupus erythematosus, as opposed to just a diaper rash or heat rash. You know, it just, we saw all the unusual things. And but they said when you examine someone and you hear hoofbeats behind you, what do you think of? Well, in the United States, and particularly here in Texas, you'd think of horses, right? But if I was over in Africa, it might be wildebeest or zebras or some other animal like that. And so I'm saying, what do you have? What do you experience around here in Texas? What do you have to prepare for? Prepare for your horses, and you'll be ready for your zebras, okay? Don't concentrate on the very unusual things, the very extreme things, the things that of terrorism, or worrying about things that are less likely to happen or that you can't really totally prepare for. But if you prepare for your common things, your horses, you'll be much better prepared to be able to handle any zebras that show up. I just want to go quickly through this list of the different types of natural hazards that you need to be prepared for. Do you have fires here? Well, obviously you have fires. I mean, Texas has been going through some major fires this year. Floods. Talked about floods here in Austin just even last year, and there's all the flooding that's going on in other parts of the U.S. Hurricanes. Hurricanes are impacting you, and even if they may not directly impact you, of course, down in the, along the coast, you're going to have a lot more impact of hurricanes here in Texas. But even after the hurricane with Katrina, look how many refugees and other people displaced came into your own area. Now, Daniel says you had 40-some thousand people that have come into the Austin area. So whether it impacts you directly or it impacts you indirectly, you still need to be prepared. And this is one of the challenges that I have for churches. I really am asking every church to at least develop a food pantry and a clothing drive as a minimum, just bare minimum. And if you're able to do so, also work out with FEMA and the Red Cross to be a designated center. Now, you can't just have that happen just overnight. You have to go through training, you have to get approval, and you have to know what the standards are. Like, for instance, people think that you can just go and offer food. Now, in a terrible disaster with everybody dying around you and real difficulties, then yes, probably you could do some things without authorization. But as long as there's some sort of FEMA input and normal disaster response input, they're going to require you to meet feeding standards in terms of even how hot you keep your food and how your kitchen is set up and all this type of thing. So you need to understand what's going to be required of you if you as a church want to get involved with FEMA. But if you're designated ahead of time, there can actually be insurance coverage for your facility if it gets damaged, not from the disaster itself, but from people utilizing your facility, and you can get reimbursed for offering services and things like this. So I'm saying this is the time for the church to be the church, to be designated and to become involved. In fact, I had one pastor down in after Katrina, there, his whole congregation was wiped out. And he was advised to do something that I feel very badly that he didn't follow through on it. But rather than trying to start his church back up, because there were no people around the church, he was advised, why don't you convert it into a transition center and put up washing machines and sleeping quarters and develop a food service and just make it a place for people to come in and they didn't do it. They instead tried to go back to become church as usual and set up church. Well, you know, it floundered. But I really think that we need to think of alternatives of how we as believers can get involved and make a difference. Now, that's not just your individual response, but I tell you what, can you imagine what would happen in the United States if literally every church had a food pantry and a clothing facility and would then become designated as a center? All of a sudden, the immediate need of pressure of food, for instance, would dissipate because there would be something available for that community. Because if there is no food available, it wouldn't take long for riots to occur, for civil order to break down, and the more people that are prepared, the less chaos there's going to be. In fact, that's one of my greatest pushes that I'm having people telling them to get ready. If you're the only one on your block that's ready, guess whose door they're going to knock on? But if you can get your whole neighborhood ready, then at least you'll have some semblance of peace for a while, because people are not going to be so anxious to be getting at your stores, whatever they are. Tornadoes. Obviously, you have tornadoes in this area, right? I know you do in Texas, but have you had tornadoes in Austin? Not so much in Austin, but in other areas within Texas, I know you've had tornadoes. You say you have had some tornadoes here in Austin? Thunderstorms and lightning, I know you would have that. Winter storms and ice storms, I know you have that, because I was over in the Lubbock, Texas area, actually a little bit further west of that, and I had to delay leaving Texas one time because semi-trailers were off the road due to the ice, and after driving a couple miles, I said, you know what, this doesn't make sense. I turned around and went back and stayed in the hotel one more night because of the ice storms. Extreme cold. Do you have extreme cold here? You don't have extreme heat, though, right? No, just... This isn't extreme. This is just normal. Earthquakes. I don't know. Do you have earthquakes here in Texas? You have some. They're not usually the major variety, per se, but I found out that when I moved to North Carolina back in 1999, I didn't realize that earthquakes are very common in North Carolina, and in particular the area where I live. I didn't even know that when I moved there, but I went back and looked up historically. The strongest earthquake on record was a 6, so that made me feel better that we're not dealing with 8s and 9s and that type of thing, but a 6 is a pretty strong earthquake. But even while we've been there over the last few years, we've probably had 3 or 4 earthquakes that I've been aware of. I'm sure we've had more. I just wasn't aware of the earthquakes that were there. Wildfires, obviously, that's a major problem that you have. Landslides and debris flow. Now, you know, so much of Texas is flat, you can't have too much mud flow without some sort of hills. But there are areas, I imagine here in Austin, you could have a few mudslides if you had excessive rain and some debris flow. Volcanoes, I don't think you have any volcanoes here. And a tsunami, I suppose you would have a risk of that with a hurricane type of damage to the high surge. We wouldn't call it necessarily a tsunami, but the surge flow, but that's the same type of damage that you would have. And I stop and think about Galveston, because that's what happened over in Galveston. And I still am amazed at how the people did not respond to authorities to say, get out of Galveston. And I still don't think we know how many people died. You know, with the number of people that are unregistered or not here legally, I don't know we would have everybody accounted for. I imagine some people got swept out to the Gulf and we would have no accounting for them. But there was no excuse for anybody to be there to lose their life, because much warning was given. Anyway, it's a shame when you see people die unnecessarily when they were given plenty of warning ahead of time. Hazardous materials incidents is another thing. I don't know what you do in terms of hazardous materials. Do you have nuclear plants here in Texas? So you have nuclear plants, so you need to be concerned about that. I didn't think we had any in North Carolina, in the area where I live. I found out that I'm not too many miles away from one in South Carolina that's just over the border, so I have to be aware of nuclear plants. In fact, after what happened over in Japan, I went ahead and got some potassium iodide. I don't know if any of you did the same thing, but I decided it would be better to have some. But don't be fooled to think the potassium iodide is going to be totally protective for you. All it does is help in terms of the radioactive iodine uptake that would occur with the radiation, but there's many other radioactive materials that are damaging to the body And so it's not as if it's a total protection, but it is somewhat protective and would be useful if one was close to a nuclear plant if they had a meltdown. And by the way, don't rely just on your own knowledge of what happens in the area where you live. If you move into a new area, go on to the internet and just type in the name of your city or where you're at and just say disasters, and it'll give you a list of all the different things that have occurred over a period of time. And if you're going to also do that, if you travel a lot, don't just think about where you live specifically, but I travel over the United States. I have to be aware of what could potentially happen in different areas where I go. In fact, that's one of the reasons why when I travel, I actually take one of these Breath of Life emergency escape masks with me, because if I go in hotels, you know, if you have to go down a stairwell, there was smoke and debris up a stairwell, I need to be able to protect my breathing. Most people who die in fires do not die from the flames. They die from inhalation and the debris and the smoke. And so having some sort of protection for that is very important. Or people who are in subways, like if I was up in New York or in other cities where they have subways, I would want to have something like that with me when I would go. If something should ever block the subway and disaster would occur and you had to escape on foot, you need to have some means of being able to protect the air that you're breathing. So you need to be aware of places like military sites that could be terrorist activity. If you have any other national monuments or places where terrorists might want to you know, have an attack, you need just to be aware of those things. It's situational awareness. And having been in 105 countries and having been in many Muslim countries, I will say this. Anybody who thinks that those under Sharia law or who are in a nation dominated totally by Sharia law or Muslim faith, that they are somehow tolerant of other religions, you don't understand Islam. The only nations that I ever had to go to out of the 105 where I really had to be concerned on a general basis for my own safety, I had to really watch what I was doing in those nations that were under Sharia law. Because the attitude toward Christians is very hostile, and I was actually over in Pakistan when there was an incident with the American embassy. We had to kind of travel in small groups, be in the back seat, keep the windows closed. The women that were with us had to wear scarves. It's just not a safe place, and we need to understand that. And what's going on here in the United States, despite all the rhetoric, it is not true. I mean, this is a spiritual warfare of the highest level. You just need to be aware of that. And this is not just being tolerant of another religion, because this is a religion that ultimately, for those that are true believers, believe that ultimately they're going to dominate the entire world, and they're going to do it either where other people peacefully accept their religion, or they will dominate them by force. And unfortunately, we don't know the history of the Crusades and what happened over in Europe and all that, but I don't want to get into that, but don't be fooled by all the rhetoric that occurs in our news media. Are you aware of what I'm saying? Are you okay? I just wanted to make sure I wasn't confusing some of you on that. So anyway, take consideration when you travel of what hazards might be involved in the areas where you go, so that if you happen to go out to California like I did, I just spoke to Messianic Jewish group out there in Ontario, I had to be aware of what might be available or what might occur out there in California. So just be aware of the situations. Next slide. Okay, H2O, what you need to know. Safe drinking water is the absolute number one priority that you have, and you need to be prepared for that at home, work, and in your car, because you never know where you're going to be when a disaster would strike. And having sufficient safe water is very, very important. I know that there's a number of things that are being offered out here for long-term storage, and in many states that's not necessary where you have abundant water available to you. But Texas is one of those areas that, depending where you're at, storing water for long term might be a very viable way to go. And there are large containers, and I know of some people that have not only the 50-gallon drums, but actually have several hundred gallons of water, and they'll catch rainwater when it does occur and fill up cisterns and then treat the water And if you have another additional means of purifying the water after you collect it to make it safe in case you have had it sitting for a long time, that's a very good recommendation. Having some sort of filtration is going to be very important. Now, there are several things out there. In fact, by the way, I think there's excellent products out there from the Berkeys, the big Berkeys. There's Katadyn, there's a Sawyer filtration, a micro method that you can use that I think it's 0.02 microns that you can get up to 1 million gallons over a lifetime of water that's safe, that even filters out viruses and bacteria. But it's, and there are some that can be used for individual use in transport. But the things that I've actually used myself and stuck in grab-and-go bags, and also because I want to have them at home, work, and in the car, and also I recommend it like for children, is that they're so small. Here's a Frontier filter. They're carbon, micropore, tortuous path filter, and it does about 99.9% of removal of contaminants, and it'll get rid of bad tastes and any kind of chemicals in the water. This will not take care of viruses and bacteria if you should have sewage contamination. That's not going to take care of that. But there are then water tablets that you can add to the water, or you can boil the water if you're concerned about sewage. But this is so convenient. It's a little straw mechanism, and you just have water in a cup or whatever and just suck it up. And how much will it do? It says officially 20 gallons, but the truth is, as long as you can suck water through it, it's good. And so if it's basically not really terribly contaminated water, you'll probably get a lot more than 20 gallons. You probably only personally need about a half gallon a day, so something like this would last, that is for your own water needs, this would last more than a month just for one individual. The other one that I also have stuck in all my grab-and-go bags has been, this is a Frontier Pro. The thing that I like about this, this is actually, has a bite nipple on this end. You can stick a 1 or 2 liter bottle. It'll fit on a bottle like this, so you put the water in there, and you can drink it like you would a sports bottle, which, by the way, there's also bottles like that out there. Has the same kind of filter mechanism as these smaller filters. This one, the Frontier Pro and the Frontier, the same carbon micropore tortuous path filter. The difference is this one actually has replaceable filters that you can purchase. These, once they stop working, you just throw them away. But the nice thing about this one is it has this expandable top, keeps the top clean for you, but it also has an adapter that lets you hook it up to a water hose if you want to hook it up to a water hose. So if you had this with you and you were away from home and there was somebody's water hose available to you, you could actually fill up containers with this. This bite valve comes off, and then this tube fits on the top, and you can just fill up different containers. This is designed to do it about 50 gallons, but the truth is you get probably 100 gallons or more if the water is basically fairly clear. Now, one neat little thing about this particular device is it's designed to be able to fit onto a water heater. So there's actually a little adapter that you can take off, put it on this. The bite valve comes off, and you stick the tube on the end, and you can fill up containers with the water out of your water heater. Now, if any of you have ever tasted any water out of a water heater, it's yuck. And you don't want to be drinking that directly. So what you want to do is you drain the water heater first of some of the junk that's at the bottom, and then you put this water filter on there, and then you fill up whatever containers you have. It'll get rid of that bad taste that you have. It'll also filter out any of the chemicals and that type of thing that you would have there. So I have seen this used whenever water service to a house has to be shut off, no more water's coming in. Stop and think, shut off the main water to your house so that no more water that may be contaminated will come into the house, and then you've got 50 to 60 to 100 gallons of good water in your water tank, if no other place. So just, that's kind of a neat little thing to use. But there are many devices out there. This is not all that's there. Take a look and determine which ones are best for you and for your own family. But have some sort of means of being able to purify your water. That's just number one. When they say that, in fact, if you read FEMA's guidelines, they say you need about 1 gallon of water per day per person. Well, can you imagine trying to have a 3-day supply, which is their recommendation, and you've got 4 people in your family, you've got 12 gallons of water, and all of them weighing close to 8 pounds each. I mean, that's an awful lot of water to be trying to haul around. And so I would say, rather than worrying about trying to haul that water, of course, if you have it in your home, having that water stored at home is fine. You can store a whole bunch at home. But if you have to leave, go in your car, or if you're found at work, having a means on you to be able to filter water is going to give you the access that you need to safe water. And so have also some little packs of water. They have, you can buy packs of water, or you can use bottled water to put into your grab-and-go bags in your car. But again, here in Texas, with it getting so hot, if you do put things into your car, I actually would recommend you put them inside of a cooler, and just so that it'll just stop them from getting the excess heat inside the cooler. And if you have to rotate that periodically, do so. But you've got to address the issue of heat here in Texas. So anyway, next slide. Don't get caught with your pantry down. That's actually a title of a book that I came across, and I used it for this particular PowerPoint. It really gets the point across. Don't get caught with your pantry down. Food is going to become even a major issue, more so as time goes on. As the price of fuel goes up, it increases the price of food. There's even talk about, you know, if there should be major disruption in our nation, whether from civil unrest or whether it's just from a whole bunch of disasters, access to food may be temporarily interrupted. I feel very badly for those people that are in high-rise apartments in large cities, people who don't have their own transportation. I wouldn't want to be in a high-rise with 40 to 50 stories and have all the electricity go out, having no transportation. I think of cities like New York, where they have twice a day, they bring in fresh fruits and vegetables twice a day. So within a day, that's going to be exhausted. And then in terms of canned goods, and long-term storage, they have like 3 to 4 days of supply in New York. But if you had a major disaster, can you imagine what would happen? If people started to break into stores, as what they did in certain type of disasters, that supply would be gone in a day. I mean, they may say they have 3 to 4 days there, but if people knew that it wasn't going to be replenished, people will hoard, they will mass buy. Then it comes down to civil unrest and people breaking in and stealing and taking things. And so I really say that you need to have, I say, 3 to 6 months worth of food at home. Okay, and I think you need to pay a lot of attention out here to the different types of food options that you have. My wife and I have pretty close to 6 months worth of food, I would say, in our own home. But we also happen to have neighbors that have goats and chickens and cows and horses and live in a rural area, I guess you can tell by that. And we tend to work together. Some of them have gardens, and having their own gardening is also an important thing. And you can do home gardening inside or just outside. You know, if you don't have to rely on just the grocery store to be able to provide a lot of your fruits and vegetables. It doesn't take much for you to actually produce more than what you personally can consume. But choose foods that do not require refrigeration. Choose foods that do not require special preparation. Select foods that require very little water for cooking. Avoid foods that will make you thirsty. By the way, and regarding this, it has both to do with cooking and also with water. I actually have a solar, solar device where I can actually, a solar cooker. It's very simple, doesn't cost very much money. In fact, if you're a good Boy Scout, you can make your own out of cardboard and tin foil and just, you know, concentrate the heat down. But on very simple devices will actually heat water above boiling. I think with a lot of these you can get up to 230, 240 degrees. You can cook in them, but you could also then boil your water with it. And so you didn't have any electricity or any alternative fuel. If you just had sun, you'd be able to make water safe. You'd also be able to cook at the same time. and you need to determine how much food you need to keep on hand. The government actually says you should only have, oh, maybe for a couple weeks, they might say, have food for 2 weeks. That is too short of a time. You really need to have 3 to 6 months, and in the book I haven't expressed that length of time, but that's what I'm doing when I'm talking with people. And the dictum that I have, or the saying that I go by, is store what you eat and eat what you store, and then do a rotational method. And so there'll be times we'll go out and my wife and I will find a good deal on some canned goods, and I try to get the longest date possible, and usually get canned goods out for 1, 2, 3 years even. I have some that go as much as 3 years, and rotate them and put the dates on them. And I would use canned goods even if they were expired, if they haven't popped up on the can and they look safe, and if I open them up and they still smells good, I would still trust that it would be safe to eat. There's a whole bunch of information on food storage that is going to be reviewed in some of these other areas, but you know, place food in a cool, dry area away from gasoline or other fuels, and if you have food in a plastic container, gasolines and other fuels, they can actually seep in through the plastic containers. You don't want to set them directly on the cement floor, like say in a garage or whatever, and rotate any kind of emergency food every 6 months to 12 months. That's the best thing to do, is just to keep current with what you normally eat and rotate it, and label the expiration date, put the expiration dates down. Alternative sources for cooking: candled warmers, fondue pots, charcoal grills, camp stoves, campfire or fireplace cooking. How many of you have a Dutch oven, out of curiosity? Okay, a lot of you do. Those are great, because you can just stick those straight into the fire if you have a fire going, and there's a lot of Dutch ovens out there that are very excellent. That's one good way to cook, and our solar cooking, as I mentioned. One of the things I do need to emphasize with everybody is make sure you have a mechanical can opener. How many of you ever tried to open up a can when you didn't have a proper can opener? Makes a Christian out of you real fast, doesn't it? I mean, I remember seeing a bear trying to go after a can and trying to open the crazy thing up, and it was just really fun to watch it, but it's not fun to do it if you can't get into the can yourself and you don't have the right tools to do so. So have a mechanical can opener. And I would put some the food in a grab-and-go bag. Having some food in your car, just like what my friend in Nashville, you know, sitting for 30 hours in a car and not having any other way of replenishing water or food. And that's where, if you had your filtration device or tablets or other means of purifying water, it would make it safe for you and you would get along just fine. And anyway, I'm going to skip over that area. Let's go to the next. And remember, being prepared yourself, if you're totally prepared and if your neighbors aren't, guess who's going to come knocking on your door? And you would hope it's going to be your neighbors, because they'll knock kindly. If it's not your neighbors, but if it's roaming bands of people that are hungry, that's a whole different story. They'll come knocking on your door. I would also then say this, both in terms of your food storage as well as your money that you keep around: don't tell people what you're doing. You know, well, I've got a year's supply of food at home. You know, I mean, you don't need to be telling a lot of people. Of course, you tell your family or those that you actually feel like you'd have a responsibility for. But be wise in terms of what you share, but get other people ready. Next slide. And cash is king. I've already given you the example about my friend in Nashville. One of my cousin's daughters lives in the Galveston area, and when Hurricane Ike came through there, she had read my book just a week beforehand, and so she pulled some small bills out of her bank. She was 10 days without access to any funds out of her bank following the hurricane. And so if you don't have small bills, you're going to be in trouble. I write in my book that having $500 on cash would be sufficient normally. The reason why I chose that number was I didn't want to put down what I really was feeling, because I thought I might put some people off. I really would recommend you have at least 1 month's worth of cash on hand to survive without having to use ATMs or anything else. Have at least a month's supply of small bills, ones, fives, tens, twenties. Consider a $20 bill as a large bill, and then be able to pay cash as you go along. next slide. This is a very, very important thing, being safely docked. I actually have here a medical memory band here that there's only a few of them. I think I only have 9 of them out here. We can always get more, but this is something that you can, it's a USB flash drive. It's only, I think it's 250 megabytes, so it's not real large. You can use just your own USB drive if you want to. You don't have to get something like this. You can get them a lot cheaper than what you can just this. But the unique thing about this one is that it has software on it that allows you to enter in your medical data that only you can alter. You can give your medical history, your insurance information, who your doctors are, any kind of medical conditions you have, what medications you're on. You can also go back in and alter it if your medications change. It's really good if you have somebody that's elderly that you're responsible for and you need to put this, it comes as a bracelet around their wrist, then if somebody should find them, you would have all that medical information in one place. They can put it into any computer and all the medical information will show up. They can't alter it, but it'll give them the information that you need. It's sort of like the dog tags and the bracelets that people have had if they're diabetic or have seizure disorders and that type of thing that people sometimes wear. Well, this is the same type of thing, it's just in digital form. And it's something that you can carry with you, stick in a purse if you need to. But the thing that I like about this and why I have it on this particular PowerPoint is it also has enough room on there. You can scan documents into here. You could actually scan important documents that you wanted to put onto a USB drive and take it with you and then make duplicate copies. So you could actually carry something like this around with you in a pouch, in a grab-and-go bag. And so no matter where you are, you could have the information that you needed. Now, one of the things that I'm also recommending to people is you're familiar with cloud computing. For those that don't know that term, that's where you have a remote storage. Well, if any of you use email and use Yahoo or Gmail or whatever, you're in cloud computing. They don't call it that, but that's what it is. You're using a remote computer or a storage device, so any of your emails are all on somebody else's computer. It's not on yours specifically, so it's saved. So each time you access Gmail or Yahoo, you're accessing their computer. And one of the things that I did when I was actually giving a lecture, actually taught a course down at Southeastern University, I had the whole outline. It was a whole lot of work, and I put it on to my computer, but I emailed it to myself. The next day, my computer crashed, and I couldn't recover it, but I had already emailed it to myself on Yahoo. I just went into Yahoo and pulled it down, and I was able to then access it. So this is something that you can do. You can do cloud computing. You can do USB type of ideas like this. You can put all sorts of documents on here, scan them, and put them into a USB, and it will allow an easy way to carry these things around. Now, in the book, because some people don't do that, I talk about what documents you actually need to carry with you, but it's a lot more cumbersome to actually have a physical document. And you should also not just have the documents at home. You need to have copies of them elsewhere, or even keeping originals maybe in a safe deposit box or keeping them in a safe, or like for instance wills, maybe give your kids a copy of your wills so that there'll be other people that will have some of these documents. Because if you were in Joplin or Tuscaloosa, Luska, and all the documents that you had were in your home, I'll tell you what, some of those are never going to be recovered. I mean, those homes were absolutely devastated. When those winds got up to 300 miles an hour, I mean, it was just awesome, the damage that was done. Anyway, I'm going to skip over that particular aspect. But original documents, you may want to keep some things at a lawyer's office, for instance. But don't always use just your home as the only site where you keep things. Next. I actually go through a whole list of things that need to be done. But it's too long for here. I'm actually going to go into more depth this afternoon on some of these areas this afternoon for those that want to attend some of those discussions. And by the way, I would appreciate if you have any questions and you plan to attend this afternoon session with me, if you would write up some of those questions ahead of time. I would like to take some of those questions and then address those specifically at that time, so I will really tailor some of the things that I say to the specific needs and questions that you do have. By the way, I should mention safeguarding your business records. How many of you ever lost data because you had a power surge? I tell you what, those special backup devices to where it'll interrupt power surges and save your data and give you power for a few hours to give you time to have a normal shutdown, that's very, very important to do that. Because in particular, if you have a business and need financial records, I myself have started going more toward digital financial records. But I have to keep an alternative site. I can't just have everything just on my one computer, because if everything was lost on my computer, I'd be wiped out. So I have to have multiple sites for storage for that information. Next. Whoa, this is it. What a difference a plan makes. Can you imagine being in this particular, go ahead and back to that last one. This is, be weatherproofed, and excuse me. What is going to happen in Austin if you lose power for a prolonged period of time? Are you prepared to handle that? You need to be making alternative plans. It is not totally a wild idea to think that you could be without power for an extended period of time. I know up in our home in North Carolina during the winter time, as opposed to the summer, I'd be more concerned here probably during the summertime for you with the extreme heat. But in North Carolina, it was ice storms, and we lost power a number of times. And we've had to evacuate our home maybe four or five times over about 12 years, sometimes for 3 to 4 days at a time, because we didn't have heat for the home. Just this year, we installed a wood-burning stove and had the experience of being able to shut off the lower level of our home, so we had no heat coming in from that except for the wood-burning stove, and it kept our home at about 73 degrees. And so it's something that I can now know that if I lose all electricity during the wintertime, I can still stay in my home. And I'm in the process of installing a generator. Now, I know a lot of you probably have generators that run 4 to 5 hours, 6 hours, and then need replenishing fuel. I really would suggest, depending on what your situation is, if you can afford it, look at alternative means of having longer-term generation of power. I personally am looking into LP gas and maybe a 500 to 1,000 gallon tank, but even that would run out after a period of time. But that at least gives you some continuity, and not just for 4 to 6 hours. Whenever you have problems like hurricanes, or like when Katrina hit, or even Galveston, in fact, with Galveston, it affected North Carolina. The pipelines that normally bring gasoline to North Carolina were shut down, and there were people getting into fisticuffs and fighting over gasoline in North Carolina, and we sometimes had to drive 20 miles to get gas. So if you happen to have a generator and don't have a lot of storage of fuel, it may work for 4 to 6 hours and help you through the rough time for short durations, but you may have to be thinking in terms of longer term, whether wind generation, water, LP gas, solar, and a lot of those things are not inexpensive, and other people are going to talk about those, and we can get into that later. But plan ahead. Don't wait until the problem happens, and try to have some plan for your family. Next slide. Expect the unexpected. This was one I actually developed initially because of the swine flu, when it was a major problem a while back. By the way, something that you should be aware of, some alternative medicine and home remedies are actually excellent for various types of problems. And one of the things that I've found with the swine flu or just general colds, elderberry extract is very good. It's Sambucol or Sambucus, if you're familiar with that. Has echinacea in it. Some of them have echinacea, and as well as the elderberry extract and vitamin C and some other things. By the way, I have been very, very upset with our healthcare professionals many times. We've been so worried about people getting skin cancer that we're constantly telling people to avoid the sun. Now, excess sun is bad, but just like excess calories are bad. But you can't live without calories, and you can't live without the sun, really, either. And one of the things that we found out here in the United States, a year ago, the pediatrics came out with a report that a very large percentage of children within the United States are vitamin D deficient, not where we have enough to where they're getting rickets and that type of thing, but they have lower levels than what they should have of vitamin D. And I was really upset with the American Academy for recommending the solution to that was to guarantee that children get 400 international units of vitamin D orally, when they can just go out in the sun for 10, 15 minutes and get several tens of thousands of units of vitamin D. So, you know, sometimes we get too zeroed in on medications and taking pills to solve problems rather than God's solution. But vitamin D is very essential to not only normal bone growth and health, but it also helps us fight infections. It's very good for your immune system. And so the sun is your friend, it's not your enemy. And one of the things that so many people have done is, and women particularly, with all the cosmetics that they use, many of them are UV blockers. They stop the ability for you to gain the benefit from the sun, and they'll tell you to put out all this these UV blockers. Now, if you're going to lay out on the beach and be there for several hours, I'd recommend that very much. But just your normal day-to-day walking around, I do not recommend putting on UV blocker unless you happen to have unusual skin problems. And there are some people where it would be recommended, but don't be afraid of the sun. It's really your friend. Next slide. When evacuation becomes necessary, in the book, I actually changed the arrow from being evacuation route sideways. We made it go up, you know, so we know our evacuation route, right, ultimately. And that's because we know the Lord. But in the meantime, until that actually happens, we know. I think of home fires, floods, hurricanes, tornadoes, wildfires, mudslides, earthquakes, loss of electrical power, volcanoes, tsunamis, radiation threats, chemical threats, terrorist threats are just a partial list of the things that may cause you to have to leave at a moment's notice from your home. And I stop and think about what's happening out in Arizona right now. They're evacuating whole towns, 2,000 people out of one small area are having to be evacuated. It's just, you never know when that's going to happen. And if you have to do it and pull something together at the last minute, it's very difficult to think about all these things. That's why you need to go down and have a list and have it all in place. And so if you know about it ahead of time, plan for it. This is another thing. How many of you have GPSs on your phones or in your car? Okay, many of you do. That's wonderful. But guess what? In places like disasters like Katrina, GPSs wouldn't work. When I'm up in the mountains in North Carolina, there are sometimes my GPS won't work in certain places. So have a GPS if you can. I think they're excellent, and I have it myself. But there are going to be times when that's not going to work. And have a physical map. Have physical maps with you in your cars. So that you'll know exactly where to go. And by the way, if you follow the evacuation routes that are designated by FEMA and by the other people for major disasters, look at what happened with Houston. Remember the parking lot called Freeway that was leading out of Houston with cars stalled and the pictures on TV with all the vehicles that were stalled? Can you imagine what a deal it would have been like being there? How many of you were involved with that by any chance? Okay, some of you, that's incredible, you know. Bathroom needs are a very real need. Gas needs is a very real need. By the way, I'm telling people, consider a half tank of gas as being empty on your car. Don't let your car go empty. Because when you actually need to evacuate, the last thing you need to do is say, whoops, I've got to go get gas. Because that's what's going to happen with 99% of the other people. They're going to have to go get gas too. And if it is a real emergency, you won't be able to get out of the area fast enough. So consider a half tank. When you get down to a half tank, say, I'm empty, fill it up. So you always are going to have adequate gas to actually get several hundred miles away from wherever it is that you call home. And so that's another thing that you should do. I would also suggest that you designate one vehicle, and many people have two vehicles. Sometimes if you have more in your family, maybe you have three vehicles. Try to designate one vehicle that you would take. Now, You may make an exception to that, for instance, if you know that the men and women are going to have to separate out, or the many times in major disasters they'll separate the women and the children from the men. There may be times when it may be necessary to take two vehicles, but obviously if you have to take two vehicles, you've got double the amount of expense for gas. You also then may get separated. There's a lot more difficulties, and if there are problems, it would be better to be together as a family than it would be to be separated. And so designate which vehicle is better to evacuate if you have that time and have the luxury of choosing. I would say designate one vehicle. And prearrange transportation. If, for instance, you're in a situation to where you cannot you don't have transportation, like I know some elderly people don't have their own vehicles. Other family members, and if you have friends or family members or others within your church that are not able to take care of themselves, then prearrange working out something with transportation and disasters. This is one of the areas that I cover in the book regarding churches. I really challenge churches to identify the elderly, the handicapped, the single parent families, people with special needs within their churches, and identify what they would do to help those church members in times of disaster, and designate somebody, not to where you just say, well, help in general, but actually where you assign and say, okay, Paul Williams, you're responsible for these five families. If there's a disaster, you get in touch with them, and if you can't get in touch with them, you drive to them if you can. You find out what their needs are, or you take care of them. Or if you, it's an elderly person that's going to need help, saying, okay, anticipating this problem, we're going to go there, take that person, take them to a safe place. Now, let me just say this. If you do this, there's going to be a lot of times that you're going to unnecessarily move people. I would rather move people unnecessarily 10 times than to have the one time when you need it and then you can't get to them and then have the disaster occur. So prearrange transportation, particularly for those with special needs. Next slide. From here to there, this is something that I put in. I didn't misspell here. It's when you hear of a problem, go there. This is something I'm telling you to teach your children or grandchildren or whoever you're responsible for, that if they have to evacuate and you're not at home, teach those that you're needing to teach this to, that if, like I'm thinking of, many children stay at home by themselves, and if there's going to be a disaster and that can be anticipated, let them know what they need to do. It may be a neighbor's home, it may be a grocery store nearby, there may be a safe place that they could go to, or among your family you could say, if there's a disaster and we get separated, where are we going to meet? If there's a problem, this is where we're going to meet. Have a place that's designated that's nearby, and also a place that's far away. And I also get into the uncomfortable situation if we should ever run into some terrorist activity. I stop and think about some of my own children and grandchildren that are up near Chicago. So if you end up having some terrorist activity up in Chicago, I could foresee some of my children needing to come down to our own home. But have pre-designated, talked out where you would actually meet should there be some sort of a major national catastrophe. What are you going to do as a family? Where are you going to get together? And I have in my book, checklist for what to do if you have to evacuate your home. In fact, one of the things I would tell you, if you do leave your home and you have time, write a note as to where you plan to go, so that if rescuers come. If you notice when you saw X's marked on vehicles and on homes with the disasters in Joplin, when a rescuers come, they'll say, this has been checked out, everything's fine. Well, if they go in and they find a note, they would then have that note and say, this is where this family went to, and they would be able to get in contact with family members that way. Next slide. Bare bone essentials. If you don't really have time to do everything you think, at least put together a bare bone essential kit. And there are many things that you can put in that, and it'll vary according to your specific needs and your age and other things. But I just think include things, water filtration systems, such as these things. These are very portable. They can be put into many different things that are portable. But there are other options as well. You don't have to think about these only. Water purification tablets or liquid, having some sort of food, a flashlight, and I would recommend it be small, waterproof, and one that doesn't require batteries. They have a lot of these that can either shake or I have a pistol grip type one that lasts for hours, and it's one of the best ones I've seen. It'll actually stay lit for a long time. Some of these shakes last for a few minutes, but there's quite a few out there that are waterproof, so that if rain or something falls into water, or if there's flooding, you at least have something that's not going to be damaged. Having a whistle, so you could, if you happen to be injured and you're trying to get people's attention, rather than trying to shout all the time, have a whistle that would be able to alert people to where you are. Having a first aid kit, and I'm going to be covering that more this afternoon as to what might go into a first aid kit. There's a lot of first aid kits available out there, but I recommend you put together your own. I really am not pleased with the first aid kits that I see. They're kind of Mickey Mouse, some of them. And I think you do a lot better job putting together your own first aid kit, and I'll go through that this afternoon. I personally recommend something like a smoke hood. You don't have to do this. There's different types of masks you can have, but something that will protect inhalation if you do get into major dust or smoke. Something to protect you that way. And then good walking shoes. That is a major, major thing that you're going to need. One of the things that was both funny and tragic was the number of women coming out of the 911 Twin Tower towers, how many shoes were kicked off and they were having to run barefoot because they all went to work with high heels and that type of thing. So take good walking shoes. Either go to work with good walking shoes on or use them, and if that's what you wear every day, then you don't have to be as concerned. But if you're wearing shoes that are not comfortable, get comfortable shoes and put them into your grab-and-go bag in your car. You have them at work, and of course you obviously would have them at home if you have those as well. Having a cord, something with a 500-pound test, a minimum of 30 feet, that can be used for many different uses. Extra money, I've already gone over that. And I also have just a few, I think I only have about seven multi-tools. It looks like a Leatherman type tool, but it's a multi-tool. The one that I have out there actually has an axe head, has a hammer, has a pliers, has a wire cutters, has several screwdrivers, knives. It's just a really interesting little multi-tool. But having some sort of a multi-tool so you don't have to carry around with you a whole bunch of tools. But in your car, you can stick a big tool bag if you want to, but for just what you have in your grab-and-go bag, have a multi-tool. You'll find that to be very helpful. I also suggest a mini pry bar, which if you happen to find yourself in a hotel and the electricity's gone and you have an elevator, have you been stuck on an elevator before? I have over in Zimbabwe. I don't think any of you want to get stuck in elevators in Zimbabwe. I guess it was Zambia. But you know, you need something you can pry your way out of different places, and they have some real small little crowbars. It'll be helpful to you, particularly if you have rubble or other things that you have to move or opening up doors, or and then waterproof matches and some sort of a bandage shears. Next slide. Have predetermined who you're going to call. Now, all of us probably in here have a cell phone, and but a lot of times these don't work in major disasters. And if you're relying on your cell phone to keep all the information of all the phone numbers that you need, as long as you've got battery power, that'll work fine. By the way, that reminds me, I would recommend you have some sort of means of being able to charge your cell phones, okay? That's gonna be very, very important. They have hand crank things that'll do it. You can also use your automobile where you have the plug-in from your automobile. There's many different ways of doing it, but make sure you have a way of charging it if you can still use your phone. But predetermine who you're going to have to call, whether it's emergency numbers or family members. Have it written down somewhere because it's not going to always stay on your computer or on your phone. They may get damaged or lost or whatever. But have a list and share that list with your other family members. Also, know the telephone numbers of your neighbors. In fact, in the workbook, I actually have a session or an area there talking about neighborhood networks. And by the way, there is reverse 911 calling. If you actually go to the Weather Channel, for instance, you can find a number that you can sign up for when there's bad weather in your area. You identify what your area is, and they will actually call you and notify you that there's bad weather approaching. So you can actually receive calls when you have bad weather. That, you can go to the Weather Channel and do that. But there's also reverse 911 numbers. I actually cover that in my workbook, where you can actually institute this information. And I've seen some churches do this, and I would think ADRN could actually do this very well with all the network of churches that you have, to where when there are disasters, you could actually send out information automatically. It'll both make a phone call, it'll fax, it'll email, it'll text, and it'll constantly go until there's an answer on the other side. So it'll get the message out to make sure that everybody's been notified. You could set up something like that for your family, to where if there's a problem with your family, you can notify them. I've seen a pastor do that, notifying their church for just routine things in terms of schedules for their church. But anyway, know who you're going to call and have it written down in a physical form, not just on your digital form. Next. I put this in, don't fritter Twitter. In other words, how many of you actually Twitter? Out of curiosity, not too many. Okay, that is sort of a new thing that's out there. Are you aware of the fact that when Iran was going through its kind of revolution and difficulties, that one of the ways that some of the reports got out was by people Twittering to each other? The social media is one of the unique ways in which communication can occur, and so that can become one link that you might want to use as a family to get in touch with each other. If you happen to leave an area, you can send pre-designated Twitter connections and that type of thing will actually work. But having a family emergency broadcasting network, or you can do it for the neighborhood as well. But get your neighbor's contact information. Next slide. Just remember that in a major emergency, you may not have communication. Next slide. Grab-and-go bags, I list in there the different things that need to be put into the grab-and-go bag. My time is about running out. He just put up a number up there that I don't like to see. But one of the things that I would say is that think of about 1/4 of your body weight should be all that you would put into a grab-and-go bag. But rather than just going by absolute weight, 1/4, put the backpack on your back and see what you can carry and see if you can do it, manage it or not. Then I also, next slide, meds to go. This is a very, very important area that I really like to cover, and I'll do more so this afternoon. Those of you that are on critical medication for your life, I think you should have at least 3 months of medication on hand at home. You need to have medication at work, some of it in your car, and if it's heat sensitive, then I would put it into some sort of a cooler and just keep it there. But I would have at least 3 months. If you can't get it because of insurance, I would say if you can afford it, ask your doctor to go ahead and approve it and pay for it cash outright yourself. To have only a month's supply is probably not adequate if you have critical meds. The other thing that you can get your doctor to do, hopefully, and that is have him write you out a prescription. For very controlled substances, they're good for about 6 months. For non-controlled substances, they're good for about a year. But so keep up to date on your prescriptions. But then if you find yourself not being able to go home, you can't get where your medicines are, you at least could go to a pharmacy and buy the medicines there and just say, you know, I can't get home, I don't have my medicines, and you would then have it. But if you don't have the prescription, trying to find a doctor and get somebody to write it for you is a real pain in the neck. And so go ahead and get those prescriptions and have at least a 3 month supply. Next slide. I thought I'd turned that off, but it's just not going off for me. There it goes. Okay, sorry about that. The device, I actually had turned it off, I thought, but obviously I didn't. It's a new phone for me. I just got about 2-3 days ago, and I haven't learned all the tricks on it, I guess. But I'm going to be going over this afternoon as well, handling special care needs. And by the way, those people that have handicaps and special needs, whether deaf or if they are blind or they're real elderly, those are different issues that you need to address and have transportation, evacuation routes actually worked out ahead of time, and prepackaged medications, and particularly issues like diabetes have to be addressed. Next slide. Another major issue is home fires, and you need to know escape routes. You need to have escape ladders if necessary if you have multiple stories. You need to have a family meeting place if you have to evacuate your home. Documentation, we've already gone over some of those areas. But one of the major things is smoke detectors and carbon monoxide detectors are very important. And the other thing I would recommend is you go through your home and you video your home. Video your contents, open up drawers and video them, because if ever you have fire damage or flood damage, you'll not remember everything that you've got. And when the insurance agents come by, they're going to want you to sign a check just as quickly as possible and settle with you, because they know that you're going to think about things that you forgot. But if you have a video of it, you can go back through and actually record what you had. Next slide. I'm going to finish up real quickly. I have a whole section on Paws for Paws. There's actually a 911 website for animals and pets. It's www.pets911.com, and they'll actually tell you what hotels are friendly to pets and that type of thing, how to take care for them. But remember, family comes first. Do not risk the lives of yourself or your family for pets. Just don't do it. They don't have the same eternal value. Just don't lose your life or jeopardize your health over pets. And if you really are that concerned about the pets, then pre-plan extremely well. Okay? Pre-plan extremely well. And so safety of the family comes first. I'm going to finish with this story. And it's the story of a young couple I know very well who had three children. One winter stormy day, their home lost electrical power and the temperatures were in the low teens. They did not have a generator, but a friend loaned them one to operate space heaters to keep the family at least somewhat warm and to keep the pipes from freezing. Little did they know that the generator was not ventilated adequately and carbon monoxide built up inside the home with the greatest accumulation upstairs where the children were sleeping. The day before, the wife had purchased a new smoke detector that also had a carbon monoxide monitor with voice alerting features. In the middle of the night, the alarm went off. Carbon monoxide high, carbon monoxide high, came the call. The family evacuated and the firemen came and measured the levels of carbon monoxide. It was at lethal levels, and they were told that the children would have died in a few hours. This story I know only too well. My wife and I have 7 grandchildren, and we could have had only 4. My wife and I daily pray for protection of our children, grandchildren, and extended family. We pray Psalm 91. We thank God for his protection. Would you show the next slide? One more slide. We thank God for his protection. We believe God caused our daughter-in-law to buy a carbon monoxide monitor just one day before. We dial on 911. We know what happened in New York. We dial 911 for emergencies, but for the believer, we dial Psalm 91:1. God bless you.